Greetings, Guardians. My name is Bife here. So today I wanted to delve into a mystery that's cropped up and been solved, kind of. Before anything else is said though, I need to give a huge shout out to our lords and saviors over on r/raidsecrets, who as always are taking the crazy puzzles that Bungie gives us and are making them understandable and solving them. Today's puzzle came from the Destiny 2 Shadowkeep Collector's Edition, my copy of which still hasn't arrived. I'm pretty sad about it, but either way, the important thing is, the puzzle within has been solved, and it's been solved by a massive group effort. For those of you who were involved either by giving your parts to the puzzle, or by simply solving it, well done, congratulations. I'm actually going to link the main thread where progress was made on this down below in the description. Either way, the cool things that came out of the Collector's Edition came from the Cryptoglyph, which people had to solve. Whatever was inside the Cryptoglyph was at first a secret, but now it turns out that there were hidden codes inside that were linked to web links on Bungie.net, and when those web links were verified, as with somebody who had collected the Collector's Edition, you would then see a series of partial Hive runes. These were in fact pieces to a puzzle. The runes were eventually pieced together, and this puzzle was then solved. The puzzle was 5 pages of Hive Arcana, and the implications of these are beyond disturbing. I will proceed to explain as much as I can, but the short version of this is simply that the Hive are trying to return Oryx to life. I will first read the transcripts in full, and then I will make commentary on each one. The first transcript, at least the first of the 3 that is relevant to this, is entitled Hearts. It reads as follows. Oryx, peerless king, whose horns pierce the cosmic horizon, who obtains meaning from the heat bath. It is us who beseech you, we, your hive. Hear as we strangle ourselves with Oryx. Call name of Oryx, which refuses itself by refusing division. Oryx, whose world line may not be mapped to any simple connected topology. Oryx, who blue shifts when all else recedes. Oryx, whose divine weapons may slice the bond of affection between master and pet. Oryx, in whom is invested the authority of 1 billion years failure to die. We, your progeny, who are caused by you as all things in your light cone are caused by your will, beseech you for your forgiveness. Let us make a manifest of our crimes. Let us not offend Oryx King with the contempt of rhetoric. Let our transgressions be known through our actions. Let our crimes be implied by the result, as the wound remembers the shape of the weapon. Ayat. This entry is just the start of something, but it identifies a few key points. Firstly, it identifies that the group of Hive talking are those that would identify themselves as Oryx's progeny. They have come to confess their sins. Keep both the idea of Oryx's progeny and the idea of heretical practices or sins being confessed or acted out in mind. We are going to, hopefully, give you an understanding of that later in this video. The next entry that we need to read, however, is entitled Endure, and whilst the 3rd and 4th entries I do not think are of immediate relevance, it is this one that gives us the next step forward. The entry itself is interesting because it is an approximation of the speech given by Oryx at the end of the Books of Sorrow. It is a speech made to his hive, and it is remarkably similar to the Insight Calcified Fragment card. It is something that we will read next. Saith Oryx, I have made preparations. If I am defeated, I know it will be because my understanding of the universe was incomplete. I know that I will fall to something mighty, something that craves might, something that loves which I love, which is a principle and a power, the versatile, protean need to adapt and endure, to reach out and shape the universe entirely for the purpose of endurance, to mutate and redesign and test and iterate so that it can prevail, can seize existence and hold it, certain that this is everything, that there is nothing to life except a living. And it has 2 faces, yet is 1 shape. One face is the objective, which is to exist, and the other face is that will to sacrifice things and ideas for a single mission, the mission of becoming the shape, a shape that is a principle, the utter commitment to survival, to drawing the right sword and choosing where to cut, that edge, that sharpness, that logic of swords. So I will prepare a book, which is a map to a weapon, and my vanquisher will read that book, seeking the weapon, and they will come to understand me, where I have been, and where I was going, and then they will take up my weapon, and they will use it. They will use that weapon, which is all that I am. They will become me, and I will become them, each of us defeating the other, correcting the other, alloying ourselves into one omnipotent philosophy. Thus, I will live forever. I am Aksukur. Saith the Hive, Oryx, our king, is defeated in echo and form, in world and in throne. His children are defeated, his tribute is cut off, his faithful son is fallen, his prodigal son entrapped and enervated by the will of thousands who would use him as bait for richer feed. Yet we survive in our thousands of billions, so numerous in our thriving mass that we could reach from moon to world and back to moon if we stood upon each other's brows. We live on by the law that we were taught, the devouring of the unfree. And that law is manifest in our flesh, which is parred to bone by the knife of need and challenge. And we, in our thousands of billions, do possess a will. Let us test the testament of our king who is Oryx. Let us challenge his legacy as he has challenged us. For there is no surer tribute to the dead than to kill all they left behind so that only the invincible and necessary will endure. He was not invincible. Thus, we must ask after the necessity of his legacy, and the need to obey his taboo. Was not Shivorath beheaded, and yet summoned back by Oryx? Who remembered her as war? Was not Savathun beheaded, and yet conjured back by Oryx? Who conspired with her cunning? Ayat, it must be so. For if his legacy is true, it will come unto us and defeat our blasphemy. And if it is not, what we attempt cannot be blasphemy, for we have survived him and surpassed the power of his will. Ayat, ayat, ayat. The first passage said by Oryx, again, is a slightly altered version of that calcified fragment, but the essence of it remains the same. This is where Oryx states and plans for the creation of the Touch of Malice, a weapon that effectively ensures his survival even after death, allowing him to live on through the weapon and the deeds of its wielder, the one who would have killed him. The response that we get is one from his Hive, and it is here that it really shows us what they're doing. This is really worth breaking down for two important parts, which I believe are these. And we, in our thousands of billions, do possess a will. Let us test the testament of our king who is Oryx. Let us challenge his legacy as he has challenged us. In the process of reading through this, I actually went back, and even though I know the definition of the word testament, I looked it up again for a more clinical one. Whilst the word testament is most commonly associated with Judeo-Christian books, and things such as the Old and New Testaments within their pages, the word testament itself actually means someone's will. So the Hive saying, let us test the testament of our king who is Oryx, is effectively a way of saying, let us test Oryx's will, which then relates to the previous sentence saying, and we in our thousands of billions do possess a will. They are challenging his legacy. They are effectively trying to, in their thousands of billions, come close to matching his will. The second part that's of importance is, thus we must ask after the necessity of his legacy and the need to obey his taboo. Was not Shivorath beheaded, and yet summoned back by Oryx, who remembered her as war? Was not Savathun beheaded, and yet conjured back by Oryx, who conspired with her cunning? Ayat, it must be so. For if his legacy is true, it will come unto us and defeat our blasphemy. And if it is not, what we will attempt cannot be blasphemy. for we have survived him and surpassed the power of his will. This, to me, hints at a very simple idea. What is the blasphemy they're talking about? I believe that the blasphemy they're talking about is the Hive blasphemy and taboo practice of resurrection and, more specifically, necromancy. They talk about this taboo, and then they talk as a counterpoint about the resurrection of Shivua Wrath and Savathun. They talk about how they were beheaded and yet conjured back by Oryx, who was able to use their key traits of war and cunning in a way that allowed him to perfectly personify them, almost honoring them and bringing them back. This idea of necromancy being taboo is expanded upon in the Strange Terrain Strike when we hear about Hive Apocrypha from Anna Bray and Nokris's powers that he attained. Of course, there is something else to note. The final sentences and the first sentences, stating that the Hive in their thousands of billions do possess a will, and that they wish to put to test Oryx's will. And beyond just this, the idea that if his legacy is true, that he would come back to them and defeat their blasphemy, and that if not, what they were attempting could not be blasphemy, because they had proved themselves to be stronger than him. This is resurrection through the sword logic, I believe. This is one way of simply saying if they bring Oryx back and what they have done to do so is seen as blasphemous, they would be cut down by him, for his will would be stronger. But if it turns out that it doesn't work, their power is stronger still than his, and ultimately, that is enough. They will be able to continue existing, even with Oryx's temples ransacked and his knights killed. All of this, I believe, translates to that idea that the Hive are now attempting to resurrect Oryx by perfectly exemplifying him. But again, I want to keep in mind that all of this is simply my interpretation of a script that has been given to us. Hive Apocrypha often is filled with lies and multiple meanings, so do not take all of this immediately with anything more than the largest of pinches of salt. However, there is something further that we can see from this which gives us even more dark context and an even more terrifying possibility. It does not come from parts 3 or 4, known as Dust or Hope, but only from part 5, Poison, which I think really drives home another possibility for the Hive's plan, one that links in with Eris Morn. That text, Poison, reads as follows. Oryx is dead. To deny this is to drink strong poison. Oryx is dead and his throne waits empty. To accept this is to accept blasphemy into our hearts. Our progenitor and forefather is vanquished. His court is scattered. His temples ransacked. The knights like hot stone are dead. The beasts like scarred bone are gone from his side. And his killers have not assumed the mantle of the taken king. How can our mighty king, the spear that pierced 100 million lying lungs, be killed by those who would deny the all-edged truth? Is this the end of progress towards the true and final shape? Is this the Enteoxuana? The fate worse than extinction? The triumph of the oldest doubt and the end of our way? Is it the incomprehensible fate which the needle-fingered one calls the fraying of the cord? No. We are a people of the real. We know the rod which separates the true from the dead. We know that whatever happens is so because it must be so. We accept that this has happened. Let me tell you what has happened. Our King of Shapes has triumphed. The one who murdered him, who wielded his killers as a knife. She was once a liar drenched in the sky. But she came among us, the children of Oryx, and we cleaned the lies from her. We scoured the confusion and fear from her, and we gave her the clarity of our sight. And she devoted herself to the task of comprehending Oryx, learning and foreseeing him, thinking as he would think, knowing what he would know. Becoming his one worthy enemy, and so becoming like him. How could she do anything but challenge him? And how, in challenging him, in seeking a way between his pits and riddles, could she walk any path but the path he made for her? The mark of him is upon her. She will always fear him. She will feel the wound of him in her mind as we feel his absence. She will seek out all that he valued. She will find all that he would want found. And lo, what has she found? What has she found? The liars will come in their thousands and hundreds of thousands and slaughter us in our millions and tens of millions, and we will go rejoicing to our ends, for they are the blade he has appointed to whittle us into our shape, and she is the avatar he has chosen to mantle him. And even now, we sail the course he plotted, for she has awakened the truth which answers the lies. And his will has delivered the liars to us as his final test. And he is still and now and forever our king. We will ask him to return to us, and when we have pleased him, he will answer. This is where things become truly troubling. It seems obvious that this passage makes reference to Oryx and Eris, who now, according to the Hive, holds Oryx in her mind as a wound. She has been persistently driven by her quest to see the ascendants of the Hive defeated and the Osmium dynasty brought to ruin, and that quest has led her ultimately to find the Pyramid of Luna. This discovery, needless to say, led to the rise of the Nightmares, which are the manifestations of Guardians' past traumas. Some of those Nightmares manifest as persons, such as Eris's old fireteam members, slain by the Hive. Others manifest as monsters, villains, and princes. So why not as a king? It has always been Oryx's obsession to learn the secrets of the deep and to study it, and in this strange sense, if Eris is to be his avatar, and is to be the proof of his continued survival as the Hive believe her to be, then her discoveries of the Nightmare is his further victory. Her discovery of the darkness is proof that he has come closer to the final shape. But more than just this, the trauma and the wound of Oryx that Eris holds in her mind may be strong enough for the darkness to manipulate it. If he was able to summon back Omnicol and Crota and all of her fireteam members as nightmarish figures, then perhaps there is a chance that a nightmare of Oryx might be conjured. All of this leads me to a set of two possible conclusions. And whilst I would remind you that all we discuss is as of yet unproven, I believe it to be critical for you all to be armed with this potential knowledge so that you might be able to confront the possibilities. The first and most probable outcome of all of this is rather simple. I believe that there is a distinct chance that, as I stated, we may see the rise of a nightmare of Oryx, born not only of Eris's obsession and trauma, but also out of the great trauma that he brought to the ranks of all Guardians through the Taken War. The more complex and terrifying question comes to whether the Hive are correct in their assumptions, and are powerful enough in their will to be able to resurrect the Taken King for good, summoning him back with their sheer force of will. Possibly the two are intertwined and interlinked. Maybe the power of the darkness and the ability to resurrect will be seen as the same for the Hive. All of this is mere speculation. All of this is unclear. But one thing that I can absolutely assuredly say is this. Arm yourselves. Be ready. Grow in strength. Grow in power. And stand vigilant. If the Cryptoglyph was speaking of these vile practices, then the Hive of the Hidden Swarm have been preparing for this moment for a long time. But more than simply this, there are more references to those that might be looking to raise Oryx from the dead. References found in the books of the Inquisition of the Damned that hint to the daughters of Crota, the granddaughters of Oryx, who may be leading the way in a plot to resurrect their grandfather. There were four amongst their original number, as best we can tell. Hashladun, the eldest, as well as Besurith, Kinox, and Voshir. The eldest, Hashladun, was slain atop the Scarlet Keep. Another, Besurith, was slain in the catacombs as we fought to recover the Cryptoglyph. As best we know, two now remain, Kinox and Voshir. And at current, the texts that we have recovered may point to these two Hive being the greatest threat within the ranks of the Hidden Swarm. Stand fast, Guardian, and be prepared. We may see soon the return of the Dark Shadow who once beheld the majestic meaning of the deep. If the Hive of the Swarms succeed, it may indeed be possible to see that Oryx, the first navigator, the ruler of the Osmium Dynasty, the Lord of Final Shapes, the Taken King, will return. And if he should, his wrath will be legend. Thank you very much for watching, and do let me know in the comments section down below what your own thoughts on the cryptoglyph and its texts are. It's entirely possible that everything I've just told you is merely speculation, and is not going to pan out. However, the implication is really strongly there. So whilst I encourage you to look into this further, I also encourage you to keep an open mind and look for your own possibilities, because at the end of the day, anything I said should not be taken as gospel. Remember, when Osiris said that he wanted to release his debates verbatim onto the people, they called it prophecy, and that led to trouble. Don't do that. Make sure that you're actually looking into this and make up your own mind. How do you think this is going to pan out? Do you think this means we'll get a secret mission? Do you think that this means we're going to get something further as context in the dungeon? Personally, I think that this hints at the potential return of the Touch of Malice, and could hint to an attempt to resurrect Oryx, or even a new nightmare hunt that will be the final nightmare hunt against Oryx's nightmare. Again, all of that is just my thoughts, so let me know yours down in the comments section below. Of course, you can also like the video if you enjoyed it, and you can hit the subscribe and the bell next to subscribe buttons so that you can turn on the subscriptions and email notifications, helping you keep up to date with my channel. But of course, know that your viewership is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been, my name is Bife. Purudasya Ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.